morning, church family. Let's all stand together as we sing, "We've Come to Praise You," because we have.
It's not even a minute. It only takes like 20 seconds to walk up here. See, Ralph's got the idea. He already knew. Let's stand up and let's greet each other and be excited for service this morning. My nose is so differently now. I didn't see him. I'm assuming no. I see heart, maybe? Inertia.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
What?
When you have something to do, the girls are so you just put blood on your back.
Really?
Yeah.
I'll deal with it. I'll deal with it. Huh, interesting. What song do you want to sing tonight? Oh, well, no, I don't. pick last time because you said the same answer. I don't know. I guess I'll pick this time too. Let me think about it. I'll let you know.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Now all I see is spots.
I just keep walking in front of it.
Yeah. Well, you guys can take a seat. We've got some announcements, exciting ones. Our new visitors, welcome. Good morning. Make sure you fill out this card. We like it. I like to call you and ask you strange questions. Fill out this card so I can. I'm just kidding, but we fill it out. We like to keep track of new visitors, and we encourage you to come back a couple more weeks before you determine if this is the church for you or not. And if not, we'll find a church for you. We're here to serve here. If you picked up a bulletin this week, we've got a bunch of announcements, a lot. There's a lot on here, and there's some that are not on here that I'll still tell you about. How exciting. Tuesday is the day. We've been working for it for the last couple months. It's the Harvest Trunk or Treat. We're going to hand out candy. We have just over 10,000 pieces. We still have room for more, always have room for more. But we've got things set up. We've got hay. We've got everything. We're pretty excited. Tuesday's the day to come do the trunk or treat, show up at 5, and we're going to go on all the way until 8 today, 8 Tuesday. There's still room to sign up. So if you didn't sign up for anything and you want to serve, there are still open spots. OCC, their packing party's coming up. It's next Saturday. The women ministry, they're packing Christmas child boxes. Men, you can come join too. It's not just a women's event. They're just hosting it. But they're packing boxes, and if you don't want to show up to that but you still want to fill a box, there are plenty of empty boxes over there to grab. And grab one, fill it up. We're excited. We've already got over 100. Maybe 150. I don't know how many we have, but I know we have over 100 already, and we can fill some more up because we've got a couple more weeks coming up. Next Sunday, we need all the church members here. Everybody, we want you guys here. We are going through the service to license Pastor Craig from being a deacon, and he'll be a pastor afterwards, and we're going to have a good time doing it, and we need everybody here for that. The title, I know. More title, more responsibility. Yeah. Dang. I'm just kidding. He does a lot around here for us already. November 11th is our church's Thanksgiving dinner. I know it's Veterans Day, but it's just like Veterans Day, free food. But for you guys that don't want to have free food, we need people to sign up and make turkeys and all this other stuff. There's sign-up sheets on the table. Sign up what dish you want to bring and bring it. It doesn't have to be Thanksgiving. I'm trying to talk my wife into fajitas. She said no, but I got a couple more weeks to work it out. I wonder who put that on there. Compass, the 12th, we're having a meeting after service. We're going to start talking about the reorganization for the business meeting, so start working on that stuff. The week of the 13th through the 20th is when those Christmas boxes are getting picked up. You can come drop the boxes if you still have some. You need to bring them in that week, because then we send them to Kingman on the 20th, and away they go to whatever country they're going to this year, and little kids will be so happy to get their gospel shared to them. Oh, there is one on here that I didn't announce. November 8th is the seniors' breakfast lunch thing. It depends on what time of day you wake up. It's breakfast for some, it's lunch for others. It's at 11. Becky is speaking, and it's going to be a good time. The theme is Thanksgiving, so you can bring a Thanksgiving dish or fajitas. It's a good option. Just throwing it out there. And the final announcement this week is our work day is coming up. We had a good work day yesterday. We worked, and we did a lot. We got concrete poured. We graded the whole lot for our trunk or treat. We cleaned some things, and it was a good time, and the weather was just perfect for the wind to come in and ruin all of our work that we did. It was a good time, though. So let's we're excited. So any other announcements are on here? If you are going to the children's ministry team leading because you're thinking about signing up or you are signing up, my boss, which is my wife, told me to tell you guys. They're meeting in the sanctuary, the old building, the old sanctuary where the nursery is. That's where the meeting is after service. So if you want to help in children's ministry in any department, go to that building right after service. I won't keep you too long. I'm only going like an hour and a half today. So let's have our ushers come forward. Let's take our offering. Let's pray. Let's get inside and worship and be so excited to serve the Lord today. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, we thank you for how great you are, how glorious you are, and how holy you are. We thank you that you allowed us to come here so freely to worship you. We thank you that you allowed us to wake up for good travels, for vehicles, for anything. We thank you, Lord. Lord, we even thank you for the wind. We don't like it, but we thank you for it because it brings that cool air that we miss so much, Lord. Lord, as we just enter your service, I pray our hearts are devoted to you and focused on you, that we just give everything we can to worship you. We give everything we can to just honor you and glorify you, Lord. As we give our offering, Lord, I pray you bless the giver, you bless the gift, that we can be good stewards of it. We can use it to further the kingdom and share the gospel even more and move our church in that direction that you're calling us to move, Lord. Be with us now as we stand and we worship you so freely. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand together now as we sing God of this City. You can remain standing or remain seated. You worship the Lord in any way that you want. You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. Yet to come, greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the Lord of creation, you're creator of all. Above all things, you are.
come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done. We believe in you, God. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this day. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done.
Great things planned for our city. Let's be a part of that. Now we're going to love the Lord with all our heart and mind and soul. Are you desperate for help? You know what it's like to be tired and only a shell of yourself. And you start to believe you don't have what it takes. 'Cause it's all you can do just to move, much less finish the race.
Children, it's time to go to children's church and color and Bible study and whatever else is going to be fun planned. Today we're going to be in the book of Galatians. We're going to be in chapter 2, verses 11 on. We're closing out our series until December. No more series. Our next series doesn't start until December. There's so much stuff going on in November. We're gonna have sermons, but no series. But we're in our final week of our Church Is series. The Church Is. Our first week, we talked about the church. It's a functioning body. It requires movement. It requires things to happen to be considered a functioning body, and how each person has a role that impacts that. And each person has a role in the church. And when that person can't fulfill the role, it's up to the rest of us church members to pick up the slack until that person can. Second week, we talked about the church, and we talked about how when we come, our job is to give our soul devotion to God, and that's it. We don't worry about anybody else around us. Nothing deters us. We come here to worship the Lord and only the Lord, and that's what the church is for. Last week, we talked about for the church to move forward, you need a healthy fear in the Lord, and you have to have that fear in order to stay motivated, to not sin, stay encouraged to share the gospel urgently, and be excited to move forward. This week we're going to talk about the church killer, the one thing the church is not. And we're going to talk about this thing closes the doors in more churches than anything else. We're talking about the church not being a place for division. It's a church. You cannot have differences. You can have differences, but you cannot allow them to divide the church. It's a place not for division. And the Bible's pretty clear on it. And as we were studying for this week, and I was looking at it, I found a very interesting thing that talks about this exact thing. Lifeway Research, it's Lifeway, but the research part of it, they did a survey on this topic. How many churches close their door every year? How many churches close the door pre-pandemic? How many churches close the door after pandemic? In 2019, right before the pandemic, it was estimated about 4,500 churches closed their door every year, while only 3,000 churches opened doors. So we have 4,500 churches closing their doors, 3,000 new churches starting. Those are not good numbers. And so they did that survey in 2019, and as they continued on in their survey, it got worse. And The Guardian picked it up right after Lifeway published this article and continued all the way through 2023 for the rest of the results. In 2019, they estimated that on a typical Sunday, 85% of the church population would attend on any given Sunday. After COVID in the spring of 2022, they found that that number dropped to 67%. And so one of the things they noticed was the age group. Why are people stopping? What happened? Where did that missing 12% go? Where did all that go? That was not good math right off the top of my head, but somewhere in that area. Where did that missing, how did it go from 85% to 67%? And they found that the typical age group that's missing is 18 to 23 years of age. And we're not talking about 18 to 23 years of age of people that don't know Christ. We're talking about active members in their church, and then they disappeared. And what they found out was after interviewing, out of every 20 people of this, 7 of them stopped going to church for 2 reasons. One, when they put their ideas into account, they weren't heard. They were just torn down and told how dumb they were for coming up with that idea. The second is the church didn't accept life choices they made. Not life choices, and I looked on this one because I said, okay, well, depends on what life choice you're making. I don't accept a lot of things, too. It's not life choices that we would say the church would not accept, but these are life choices as simple as whether I'm living with my parents or I'm not living with my parents. At 22 years of age, they say churches didn't accept that. And so through that, they found every 20 young adults, 7 of them are leaving the church. They go a little farther into it, and they say, in 1972, the American population, the population that claimed to be active church members, was 92%. That's a pretty high population. That's some good numbers. I like that one. Due to the decline in the direction we're facing, where church division is coming in and it's splitting, one of the things they estimated was by 2070, that number will be under 50%. It's currently at 70-something like that, in between there, in the 70s. And so through this survey, what they found was that there's a lot of things that causes churches to close their doors, but the number one thing they found that causes a church to close their door is division in topics that are meaningless. Division in, it could be as simple as, I don't like the color of the carpet, this group does like the color of the carpet, you know what, we're done. And they split off from the church, and that's the most ridiculous one I've read. Other ones, there's some more theological divisions, there's some more argumentative, but that one was the one that I read that caught my eye, color of the carpet. But they're finding that dividing in a church and not standing your ground as a Christian and working it out the way Matthew tells us to work it out has been the number one cause for churches closing their doors. And so through this information, we looked at division and church split is, that's a killer. It's a church killer. And so today we're talking about the church is not a place to divide. And graciously, this happens for us, and we read this in Scripture, and if anybody's ever read Galatians, it's one of my favorite, is it talks about church split. It just doesn't talk about church specifically, but it talks about Christians splitting. It talks about the differences. So our passage today, Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 through 16, and it says this. It says, "But when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he was eating with the Gentiles. But when they came, he drew back and separated himself, fearing the circumcision party. And the rest of the Jews acted hypocritically along with him, so that even Barnabas was led astray by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas before all of them, 'If you, though a Jew, live like a Gentile and not like a Jew, how can you force the Gentiles to live like Jews? We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners, yet we know that that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but through the faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law, because by works of the law no one will be justified.'" Let's open in prayer. Father God, Lord, you're good, and we thank you, Lord. Lord, we pray that we can be a church that's justified. We pray that as we dive into your word that we can just be a church that doesn't divide, a church that's honoring to you and glorifying to you in everything we do. In Jesus' name, amen. So we have an issue that Paul's dealing with. He's dealing with a very similar issue, and I like this issue because it's not a typical church issue, because it's not dealing with just a regular member, but instead he's dealing with Cephas. For you guys that don't know who Cephas is, that's Peter, the man that walked with Jesus, the man that denied Jesus three times, saw the resurrection. It's Peter, and he's dealing with Peter in this aspect because they both have roles in here. And I think it's important for us to understand the roles of Paul and understand the roles of Peter in the New Testament church to get a better feel on why this is happening. So Paul's role when he got saved was to bring the gospel to the Gentiles, anybody that's not Jewish. Mostly was the Romans and the Greeks. Peter's role is to bring the gospel to the Jews because he's Jewish descent. And if both of them worked perfectly together and they worked hand in hand and did exactly what they were supposed to be, then everybody at the time would get saved, in theory. Obviously, sin, nature comes into play. Our flesh comes into desire. But that is their roles. And what we're dealing with here now is an issue where Paul is dealing with something that goes bigger beyond the churches. Instead, he's dealing with an issue that the disciples that walked with Jesus are starting to fall into a fleshly desire due to fear of what the opposite party they're dealing with says to them, the circumcision party. So as Peter's having this argument during the time, they're sharing a meal with each other, and Peter instead decides, I'm not going to be with the Gentiles anymore, I'm going to go be with the Jews, because I don't want the Jewish people to see me eat with Gentiles for fear what they might do. I mean, there's a lot of options that could happen. His credibility as a Jewish person could go right out the window. This wasn't something where it was, hey, us and the Methodist church down the street don't agree, so we just don't attend each other's church service. This was something as much as we can't walk on the same side of the road because you're dirty and I'm not. This was a big social difference. This was not something that was normal. And so when he sees them coming, I don't want my credibility ruined, so I'm going to go sit with them. I'm going to pretend they don't even exist. That could happen. The other thing that could happen is the Jewish party could get mad and say he's breaking Jewish laws and put him to death. Now, we hope that wouldn't happen because we're dealing with new Christians. We're dealing with people that have heard the gospel and that are believing with Jesus. But that very much could have been a thing. And it was getting so bad to the point that when he was letting this fear control him, he even converted Barnabas, who arguably was Paul's right-hand person next to Timothy. Barnabas went everywhere with Paul. And so during this time, while he's sharing fellowship and they're supposed to be having a good time and they're finally merging that church together, Paul feels the need to publicly confront him in front of everybody and bring the focus back to what the church actually is. The church isn't a place of, oh, you're circumcised and you're not circumcised, so let's split the church. But instead, if you live like a Jew, but you live like a Gentile, then you can't expect them to live the other way. Why? Because we're not justified by how we live or what we do. The only thing we're justified in is through Jesus. And he publicly criticizes him. And so during this time, Paul brings it to a focus, and this is where we see in Scripture it talks about division of the church, and it brings us in relatively on how it relates to us. In Galatians, the division in the church, Paul separated himself from others. He didn't just separate himself, but instead pulled himself away and said, I'm going to be different. Out of fear or out of whatever it is, I'm going to go with what makes me comfortable instead of shine for the glory of Jesus. Then that fear came over, and it ended up, well, here's Peter separating. And as Peter's separating himself, the whole Jewish party followed. That shows some influence that Peter had. That's some pretty strong influence. I'm not going to go sit with them. And the rest of the Jewish people that are sitting with them get up and follow, including Barnabas. And then the final thing that happens is everything they know about Jesus goes out the window. And they start acting a specific way, hypocrisy, to the Gentiles. It's no longer about Jesus. You guys are now, because the Jewish party is here, you guys are now dirty and don't talk to us, don't sit with us, don't be a part of us. This relates to us, because in the church today, how many times do we have this? In the church today, they find that in surveys and researches and all this, they find most of the churches separate themselves by time. How long I've been a church member at a church versus how long you've been a member, or how long I've been a Christian versus how long you've been a Christian. They separate themselves by age. We're a church, I'll give you an example of this. They separate themselves by age. We're a church, and we only care about a specific age group, and that is it. There's a church in Las Vegas, in the Southern Baptist faith, that has that exact thing. Their target is 40 and below. If you're above 40, you can attend the church, but there's no Bible study classes for you. There's nothing for you. Because they've deemed when they open their doors, we're going to be a church that reaches the age group 40 and below. And so even their pastor's under the age of 40, and when he starts to get over that age, they find a new pastor and they move on. They target a specific, we're a church for this age group and this age group only. And I've seen churches on the other end of the spectrum of we're a church for the seniors and the seniors only. And if you're not a senior, we have nothing for you. As churches, we separate ourselves. Through gender, we separate ourselves on minimal issues, big issue we talk about. And we actually were just talking about this yesterday. The Southern Baptist, we separated from a church because they had a female pastor, all because of the gender of her. Whether you agree with that or disagree with that, we're not going to debate that. But as Southern Baptists, we don't believe in that. So much that this was the biggest church in the Southern Baptist Convention, and we disfellowshipped them as a convention. And they're no longer Southern Baptists, all because they hired a female pastor. We separate ourselves by race. I read an interesting article that said there's only one race in America that does not have specific race churches. Latinos. They go to multiple race churches, unless you go to a Spanish-speaking church. But if you go to an English-speaking church, it's not all Latinos. It's not all, not like we have gospel churches where they're, people commonly refer them as the black church, or we have all American traditional churches, which is the white church. We separate by race. We as a church today separate ourselves through these differences. That's the first thing we do that relates to the Galatians. The second thing we do is we fight over biblical or traditional standards versus what biblical truth is. Well, we've always done this way. We have to do it this way, but that's not what the Bible says. We're just doing it because legalism says we have to, because the church says we have to. It's not that the Bible says, but because traditions dictate that. Arguments, as much as they follow differences on how we speak in tongues or how Pentecost happened, how baptisms happen. We fight over the traditions on how we do it rather than what the biblical truth says. Final thing we do is we act hypocrisy towards each other. And this is one of the most common things we find in the church today is we say one thing to a person, but when we're talking about them in private, it's a completely different conversation. When we're talking about them with them not around in private, I guess I should have explained that. Not in private with them, but when you're talking to somebody else about them, you're having a whole different conversation, and we're talking a whole different way about them. And we as a church, we'd like to say we don't do that, but we in fact do this commonly all the time. How do we work past this? How do we move past the problem? Well, Paul gave us the steps to end division. He gave us that steps on how we move forward as a church, because today the common church acts so much like Galatians. It's amazing. It's crazy. We were talking, me and Ralph were talking today, how Amos is almost exactly what's happening today, but instead you see any book and it's exactly the church acts it today. For instance, look at Israel. In America, 78% of Christians think Hamas is justified for doing what they're doing. That's amazing. That's amazing. I can't believe that when that article came across my desk. Thinks Hamas is justified what they're doing. Now, are they misled and they think something else is happening? Maybe. Are they thinking and oh, they're justified because scripture's being fulfilled and we get to go to heaven one day? That's a good argument. It's not a good one. It's not a valid one, but it's a good argument, I suppose. We don't know, but we know in today the church is divided over the way Israel should be treated rather than what does the Bible say that Israel should be treated. And so how do we work past this big problem that has today? Paul gives us that answer, and he talks about how do we stop division. I realize I am not clicking like I'm supposed to be. My wife made good slides, too. Aren't they so nice? She's going to be so upset when she realizes nobody's seen them. Well, teach her to teach children's church. How dare she, right? Well, he gave us, here's our divisions, right? Here they are. Look at that. They're beautiful. Right? Peter separated himself from others. He spread fear over the Jewish, acted hypocrisy. We do the same thing. How do we stop division? Now we're on the right track. We're on the right slide finally. We're only 17 minutes in, but we're on the right slide now. How do we stop division? Well, the first thing he said is this. He addressed it publicly. This wasn't a conversation that he brought in and he said, hey, we need to talk in private. But instead, when Cephas was acting the way, he didn't just wait when Cephas got here and said, hey, let me talk to you, Peter. I got to tell you something. Instead, it's scripture says he sat down and waited till everyone gathered, and then he said, I need to tell you something in front of everybody. See, if there's a problem in the church and we go to address it, when you're in public, in a public format, we don't speak in private. And as the church, we understand something. Why can we do it publicly? Because we worship the same Lord. We have the same Savior, and we should be able to address issues with each other because we love each other. We should love each other. We should care about each other. We should be willing to go work through whatever problem we're having step by step with each other. One of the things a couple churches do, and I kind of like it, we're going to start adopting it here, is whenever they have a conversation, they address something publicly, they start the conversation in prayer, and they end that conversation in prayer, because as we trust in the Lord, then we should allow Him to dictate the conversation. But we address it publicly with each other. It's not a private matter. As a church, we work towards those things. Another thing that Paul explained to them is this. He said, do not let traditions dictate our lives. It's not about traditions. It's about what Scripture says. We live by what the Scripture says, and I talked about this when we talked about worshiping God. I'm Southern Baptist through and through. I was born and raised. I've never been to another church other than a Southern Baptist church, and I love it. But when the Southern Baptist faith and the Baptist faith and message contradicts what Scripture says, I don't love it anymore. I'm a Bible believer first. If we can't say this is God's complete word, and we believe wholly in this because that's what the Baptist faith and message says, but when this contradicts what that says, we go with the Baptist faith and message. It's not how it works. We believe this first, and then we're Baptist second, God's word first. And so when we go into that, we can't let traditions dictate our culture on how we live our lives or how we should interact with people when it comes to running the church. But instead, what we should do is we let the Bible speak for the direction the church says we need to go and how we need to do things. It doesn't matter on issues of, well, we've always done it this way and that's how we have to do it. It doesn't matter what happened in the past. When we're moving forward in God's vision, we should remember the past and never forget it, but we should always be looking to the future on how can we cultivate the culture to help the kingdom grow. In Paul's time, the one thing that I think is so unique about Paul and why he got to write so many letters versus everybody else is he had one job, share the gospel to the Gentiles. That was his job. But Paul didn't say that was my job. Instead, Paul said, it doesn't matter who I talk to. It doesn't matter who I interact with. It doesn't matter if you're Jew. It doesn't matter if you're Gentile. You're getting the gospel from me every time. And that's the way Paul operated. That's the greatest thing about Paul. He didn't care. He, Even the disciples, I mean, imagine how bold you have to be to go up to the disciple that walked with Jesus and say, "You're wrong." That's a pretty bold man. But during his time, he didn't care, because in his mind, this church that God envisioned and told him that they're going to start, they're moving to make that New Testament church, was a place that provided everyone's culture. It was a place that provided room for everyone's culture in order to go the kingdom of heaven. That's it. In reality, if you think about it, unless you're preaching heresy, there's no bad way to share the gospel of Jesus. Well, probably don't scream in somebody's face about it. That's a little weird, but some people like that. There's no bad way. We don't let traditions dictate our lives. And the final thing that he gave us was this: remember our purpose. Oftentimes in church divisions, and when I was going through these articles and we're talking about the divisions in the church and we're seeing reasons why church closed their doors and all these things, there's one common theme, and it's this exactly thing that Paul talks about here. Is churches forget why they were created to be the church in the first place. Why did you come together to be the church? What's our purpose? The whole purpose for our church. We come together as a group of believers to worship God. And we're able to share ideas. We're able to disciple each other. We're able to grow in what God's word says. So that way we as a community can go out and share the gospel to everybody else in the community that's missing out. That's the purpose of the church. And when you look at the reason why church closes these doors, they've missed that purpose. Our focus as a church is on Jesus. And if it's not on Jesus, we have to get on Jesus. We don't allow opinions and divisions to cause the split the church. As long as it fits the purpose, it's welcomed. And those are the three things how we stop division in our church, because the church is not a place for division. Instead, it's a place where we get to cultivate and share the gospel of Jesus, because he's single-handedly the greatest thing that has ever happened to anybody. And I will argue and I will die on this hill, because nobody can take me off of it. So that brings us to our life application, and I thought long and hard on how to word this, and this is the best we got. Is a church divided is a church that has secrets. A church that has division, and it has secrets. And we as a church, we can't be a church that has something to hide. We can't be a church that's divided. In the book of Titus, it even tells us to be publicly about it and talk to people that are causing division. Titus chapter 3, verse 10, it tells us that we talk to people when someone's causing division in the church. You talk to them not once, not twice, but after the third time, you discontinue with that person. That person has no heart in the gospel, but instead that person is trying to split Christians. And that's not our purpose. But instead our purpose is, we shouldn't have secrets if we have one common goal, and that's to share the gospel. We as the church should be able to be open, and we should be united about everything we do. There are no secrets. There are no hiding things. You should be able to ask any question you want. There's always an answer. As long as it's pointed towards the gospel, it's welcomed. And that brings us, as we close, is, have you caused division? The nice part about it is that Peter didn't just say, "Okay, I'm done," and he ran away. Paul yelled at me, hurt my feelings. I imagine there was a little more fear in it, because at one point in time, Peter was afraid of Paul when Paul was Saul, and he knew exactly who he was. And there was a fear of, that man's going to kill me. I don't know how I'd feel about the man that I was afraid to kill me is now the man confronting me about the gospel. But I imagine there was some fear in it, and Peter very much could have thrown his hands up and said, "I'm afraid, I'm done, and I'm going to go away." We see him run away. He did deny Jesus three times and run away. But instead, we see that Peter instead went on and wrote two books afterwards and continued to share the gospel to the Jewish community. The nice part about it was that they were able to work out their conflict and talk. They were able to say, "What's our issues? Let's move forward in it." As a church, do we have issues? Have we wronged somebody? Have we gossiped about somebody? Have we done anything that causes that division? And that's how we fix it, as we confront each other and we talk about it. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, you're incredible, Lord. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his blood. We thank you for his death, his resurrection. We thank you for all of it, Lord. Without it, we wouldn't have a purpose, Lord. I pray that right now, as we're just getting ready to finish worshiping you and close our service, our focus is on you. We're a purpose-driven church. We want to share the gospel to everybody. We want to welcome everybody. We want to be a church that creates a culture that everybody is welcomed here. in order to help spread the gospel to you. Be with us now as we close our service, that we just worship you and give everything we can as a group of believers to you and honor and glorify you. And even that's not enough, Lord, but I pray that we can just give as much as we can. Be with us now. In Jesus' name, amen. As we sing this song, we have opportunity. You can come and pray with one of us. If you're having issues or you're having problems and you need to discuss them, come discuss them. Let's talk about them. Let's pray. Let's work through it as a church together. If not, let's stand and let's worship so freely the God who deserves it.
He is here for the broken, life to the one who is undone. He is peace to the wounded and hope for the helpless one.
It's time to go out praising the Lord, right? Here we go.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. With all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength.
have a blessed with all your heart Sunday, and you are dismissed.